Well, hello, and thanks for joining me for our fifth online class here at Second Prez, looking at C.S. Lewis's The Screwtape Letters. I want to thank everyone who participated in our first afternoon tea with Screwtape on November 1st, and I hope you can join me for our final afternoon tea with Screwtape on November 29th from 4 to 5 p.m. on Zoom. Email me at screwtapequestions@outlook.com if you wish to be a part of our final discussion of this wonderful book. This week, we will look at an especially timely topic, given the week we've all just had, something we might appropriately call the election week from hell. Regardless of how your particular candidates fared, I think we all suffered. Many of us worried that gone are the days where we actually know results on election day. Many of us are worried that the uncertainty about the election may lead to violence. And many of us are worried that if our candidate doesn't win, then all of us are lost. It's this kind of fear, a fear that comes from our looking to the future and what might happen, that we will be discussing this week as we look at Screwtape's understanding of the past, the present, and the future. When I was working on the schedule, I thought I might try to get this class out before the election, but now I think it's better for the week after, for our country continues to experience this terrible division along party lines, with each side afraid of the other, or more to the point, what the other party might do with its power. And to get us started, I wanted to take a moment to remember where we've been and take a second or maybe third look at a letter we've discussed in prior classes. You might recall that Lewis first wrote and released the Screwtape Letters while England was enduring the Blitz in the early stages of World War II. France had already fallen, and Hitler expected Great Britain to surrender next, and there was a very real chance that Europe might fall completely under the power of Nazi Germany. So it comes as no surprise while reading the Screwtape Letters to find several letters addressing this fear of the future and the anxiety this fear creates. It is this very reason, the Screwtape Letters' comments on fear, that makes it an excellent book for us to be reading while so many of us here in America and really across the globe are dealing with the fears and anxieties associated with the future caused by COVID, by racial injustice, by economic uncertainty, and of course, by our political divisions. So let's dig in on what Lewis can tell us about this fear. And we're gonna start by looking at letter 13, which we've looked at several times before. In the plot of the Screwtape Letters, letter 13 was a crucial one in the life of the patient, as it marked his first repentance and return to faith after his conversion. Remember, he'd gotten caught up with some friends who are now leading him astray, but then something happened. Last week, we looked at this letter and we focused on the asphyxiating cloud that surrounded the patient during this moment of repentance and grace. It also serves as a nice transition to our topic for this class. Because remember, the evil's approach to unity comes from consumption, by absorbing the patient's will into its own, and how Screwtape couldn't understand God's plan, which talked about love and bringing all things to God, but yet somehow allowing us to remain distinct from God, the ultimate expression of God's love and something that's entirely outside the understanding of evil. So Screwtape writes to Wormwood in letter 13. He writes, "Well, of course, I know that the enemy also wants to detach men from themselves, but in a different way. Remember always that he really likes the little vermin, and he sets an absurd value on the distinctness of every one of them. When he talks of their losing themselves, he only means abandoning the clamor of self-will. Once they've done that, he really gives them back all their personality and boasts, I'm afraid, sincerely, that when they are wholly his, they will be more themselves than ever." And it's this point that in God, we are actually more ourselves than ever that we discussed during our tea time on All Saints Sunday, but I wanted to make it again. Lewis is making this counterintuitive argument that when we surrender our lives to God, we become more ourselves. we become who God intended us to be. That is a very powerful claim, and one that Screwtape finds utterly ridiculous, because as we talked in the last class, evil cannot understand love. Well, let's now start transitioning to today's topic by looking at another part of letter 13 that has been a great source of comfort for me during this year of COVID. We've mentioned several times that this is the letter where the patient has had a renewal of faith, but we've never talked about what caused it. And so here Screwtape writes of Wormwood's blunders, of what he allowed the patient to do. On your own showing, you first of all allowed the patient to read a book he really enjoyed, because he enjoyed it, and not in order to make clever remarks about it to his new friends. Remember, these were the friends that were leading him astray and encouraging him to be someone he was not. And in the second place, you allowed him to walk down to the old mill and have tea there, a walk through country he really likes, and taken alone. In other words, you allowed him two real positive pleasures. Now, I love that this moment of grace had nothing to do with anything we'd call religious. He simply read a book he really liked, and then he went for a walk in a country he really enjoyed and had tea, all because he really enjoyed it. I have taken this idea to heart, and during COVID, I have read several books simply because I really liked them. They weren't bestsellers or on the must-read lists. They were just books I really liked. And when so much has been taken away, it was nice to find these simple pleasures, and I hope that you have found them too. Well, getting back to this letter, we know that there's danger involved in pleasures, because from our earlier classes, we know that when we're talking about pleasures, we are on the enemy's ground, of course, because God is the creator of all these pleasures. But Screwtape is also going to point out something else that's dangerous about pleasures that will be relevant for today's class. The deepest likings and impulses of any man are the raw material, the starting point with which the enemy has furnished them. To get away from those is therefore always a point gained, right? Evil cannot create the pleasures, but has to twist them. And what Lewis is telling us here is that what we enjoy, what we like, has been hardwired into us in some sense by God. And so evil, of course, wants us to get away from those things that we like. And now we're going to focus on another danger about pleasure that connects with today's topic about anxiety about the future. And this is the other problem of pleasures, not just that we're on the enemy's ground. But Screwtape says to Wormwood, "Were you so ignorant as not to see the danger of the book and the walk? The characteristic of pains and pleasures is that they are unmistakably real. And therefore, as far as they go, give the man who feels them a touchstone of reality." This is the other problem of pleasures, right? That it gives us a touchstone of reality. But why is Screwtape upset about this? What is Lewis trying to tell us here? Well, let's hold on to that idea for a moment. And to help us answer the question, we're going to look at three more letters, because what we'll see is that one of evil's prime weapons is moving us away from what is real, because what is real, we're going to find out, is always connected to God. First, we'll look at letter 6. All right, Screwtape begins letter 6, delighted to hear that the patient might be called up for military service. And then he writes, "We want him to be in the maximum uncertainty." This, of course, is that he's most likely to get called up for military service because of his profession and age. So that his mind will be filled with contradictory pictures of the future, every one of which arouses hope or fear. There is nothing like suspense and anxiety for barricading a human's mind against the enemy. He wants men to be concerned with what they do. Our business is to keep them thinking about what will happen to them. Notice the language Screwtape is using about the future and how thinking about the uncertainty of the future leads to anxiety and suspense. And that, of course, leads to the barricading of our minds against the enemy. What's going on here? Well, I don't know about you, but this past election week has been nothing but anxiety and suspense for me and my family, as we have experienced the maximum uncertainty over the election, whipsawing, depending on what projection you're looking at and how many votes had come in. It all creates uncertainty about what it means for our future. But I love this little subtle bit of encouragement from Lewis that explains what God wants versus what evil wants. Evil wants us fretting about what will happen to us in the future. God wants us concerned with what we are doing now in the present. But let's continue with this letter because Lewis has more to offer us. Your patient will, of course, have picked up the notion that he must submit with patience to the enemy's will. What the enemy means by this is primarily that he should accept with patience the tribulation which has actually been dealt out to him, the present anxiety and suspense. It is about this that he is to say, "Thy will be done." And for the daily task of bearing this anxiety and suspense, that the daily bread will be provided. What then is Lewis saying to us about dealing with anxiety and suspense? It's not that we're trying to pretend them away or ignore them, but instead to recognize that in the midst of our present anxiety, what we are feeling now, we are to call upon God for thy will to be done, and to ask that God give us our daily bread, to give us the strength to bear this anxiety, to bear this suspense. Now, I'm sure at this point, you are noting the connection with the Lord's Prayer, and we'll come back to that later. But for now, notice the point Lewis is making about where God wants our attention, not on the future and on what might occur to us, but on the present and the strength to bear our worries about the future. And perhaps more importantly, we should be asking what we should be doing now to address those future concerns. Something I've been saying a lot recently is the prayer, God, give me the grace to meet the challenges of this day. When letter 14, Lewis reinforces these ideas of patience and focusing on the present in letter 14, which of course continues right after the patient's repentance in letter 13. And here, Screwtape has noticed a subtle difference in the patient's attitude now compared to his initial conversion. Screwtape writes, "The most alarming thing in your last account of the patient is that he is making none of those confident resolutions which marked his original conversion. No more lavish promises of perpetual virtue, I gather, nor even the expectation of an endowment of a grace for life, but only a hope for the daily and hourly pittance to meet the daily and hourly temptation. This is very bad." Well, what is Lewis telling us? Evil wants our attention placed on the uncertainty of the future. God wants our attention on the present, asking only for the grace to meet our daily and hourly temptations. Now, let's not take this idea further than we should. Obviously, God wants us preparing for the future and planning for the future, but we need to be careful when we start worrying about the future. Well, we've now come to another of my favorite letters that's so chock full of Lewisian nuggets about dealing with anxiety in the future. I'm going to have all the words up while John Cleese reads them to us in case you don't have your book handy. If you do, turn to page 15 and read along. We'll come back after we've read it and listen to it to discuss some of the letter's key statements for this class.
Letter 15. My dear Wormwood, I had noticed, of course, that the humans were having a lull in their European war, what they naively call the war, and am not surprised that there is a corresponding lull in the patient's anxiety. Do we want to encourage this or to keep him worried? Tortured fear and stupid confidence are both desirable states of mind. Our choice between them raises important questions. The humans live in time, but our enemy destines them to eternity. He therefore, I believe, wants them to attend chiefly to two things, to eternity itself and to that point of time which they call the present. For the present is the point at which time touches eternity, of the present moment and of it only. Humans have an experience analogous to the experience which our enemy has of reality as a whole. In it alone, freedom and actuality are offered them. He would therefore have them continually concerned either with eternity, which means being concerned with him, or with the present, either meditating on their eternal union with or separation from himself, or else obeying the present voice of conscience, bearing the present cross, receiving the present grace, giving thanks for the present pleasure. Our business is to get them away from the eternal and from the present. With this in view, we sometimes tempt a human, say a widow or a scholar, to live in the past. But this is of limited value, for they have some real knowledge of the past, and it has a determinate nature and to that extent resembles eternity. It is far better to make them live in the future. Biological necessity makes all their passions point in that direction already, so that thought about the future inflames hope and fear. Also, it is unknown to them, so that in making them think about it, we make them think of unrealities. In a word, the future is, of all things, the thing least like eternity. It is the most completely temporal part of time. The past is frozen and no longer flows, and the present is all lit up with eternal rays. Hence the encouragement we have given to all those schemes of thought such as creative evolution, scientific humanism, or communism, which fix men's affections on the future, on the very core of temporality. Hence, nearly all vices are rooted in the future. Gratitude looks to the past and love to the present. Fear, avarice, lust, and ambition look ahead. Do not think lust an exception. When the present pleasure arrives, the sin, which alone interests us, is already over. The pleasure is just the part of the process which we regret and would exclude if we could do so without losing the sin. It is the part contributed by the enemy and therefore experienced in a present. The sin, which is our contribution, looked forward. To be sure, the enemy wants men to think of the future too, just so much as is necessary for now planning the acts of justice or charity, which will probably be their duty tomorrow. The duty of planning the morrow's work is today's duty. Though its material is borrowed from the future, the duty, like all duties, is in the present. This is now straw-splitting. He does not want men to give the future their hearts to place their treasure in it. We do. His ideal is a man who, having worked all day for the good of posterity, if that is his vocation, washes his mind of the whole subject, commits the issue to heaven, and returns at once to the patience or gratitude demanded by the moment that is passing over him. But we want a man hag-ridden by the future, haunted by visions of an imminent heaven or hell upon earth, ready to break the enemy's commands in the present, if by doing so we make him think he can attain the one or avert the other, dependent for his faith on the success or failure of schemes whose end he will not live to see. We want a whole race perpetually in pursuit of the rainbow's end, never honest, nor kind, nor happy now, but always using as mere fuel wherewith to heap on the altar of the future every real gift which is offered them in the present. It follows then, in general, and other things being equal, that it is better for your patient to be filled with anxiety or hope, doesn't much matter which, about this war than for him to be living in the present. But the phrase, living in the present, is ambiguous. It may describe a process which is really just as much concerned with the future as anxiety itself. Your man may be untroubled about the future, not because he is concerned with the present, but because he has persuaded himself that the future is going to be agreeable. As long as that is the real course of his tranquility will do us good, because it is only piling up more disappointment and therefore more impatience for him when his false hopes are dashed. If, on the other hand, he is aware that horrors may be in store for him and is praying for the virtues wherewith to meet them, and meanwhile concerning himself with the present, because there and there alone all duty, all grace, all knowledge, and all pleasure dwell, his state is very undesirable and should be attacked at once. Here again, our philological arm has done good work. Try the word complacency on him. But of course, it is most likely that he is living in the present for none of these reasons, but simply because his health is good and he is enjoying his work. The phenomenon would then be merely natural. All the same, I should break it up if I were you. No natural phenomenon is really in our favour, and anyway, why should the creature be happy? Your affectionate uncle, Screwtape.
As you can see, Lewis has filled this letter with so much to discuss. I'll try to break it down to the essentials as it relates to today's topic, and other pieces of it we can discuss at the afternoon tea on November 29th. The key point, I think, is this one, and probably the key to the whole discussion, that we live in time, and that only in the present does time touch eternity. It might be helpful for you, if you think of God's kingdom, to think of the present being the time in which God's kingdom is both being made here on earth as in heaven. It's the thin place where the two meet, where time touches eternity. But here we find the connection with our earlier talk about pleasures and pains being real. It's because we experience them in time. But what does Lewis mean by this? I think that this letter might be one of the tougher ones to untangle with all the reverse theology and backwards reading that we need to do, but here's how I explain it. The only place where we experience God, where we see God's actions in our lives, where we are touched by the Holy Spirit or by God's grace or Jesus' love or whatever you call the experience of the divine, is in the present. And those pleasures and joys and pains are actually a connection with God. The past, as Screwtape explained to Wormwood in this letter, is of limited value to evil because we remember it, we experienced it, which might include experiences with God. When we are faced with anxiety and fear, it can often be good to remember those times in our past where God did show up, where God was active, where God did light the darkness, and we can use the past to strengthen us for today and tomorrow. Think of the great lyric from the hymn, Come Thou Fount of Every Blessing, which invites us to raise our Ebenezers. Dickens was intentional about naming Scrooge Ebenezer, as that word comes from the Old Testament, where Samuel raised up a memorial stone to remember God's help after a battle and called the place Ebenezer, the stone of remembrance. So while it might be helpful to make the patient look back to better times in order to produce disappointment in the present, Screwtape acknowledges that there are dangers of using the past and therefore prefers to make the patient look to the future. So given the past week we've had and really the past year we've had, I think all of us understand the problem with the future And of course, how evil can use it to fan the flames of fear and anxiety. Screwtape writes, it is of course far better to make them live in the future. Why? Because as he writes, it's unknown to us. And when we project ourselves into that future, it is often full of what he writes are unrealities. Again, notice the theme to move us away from reality, where we experience God in the present, to the future. Because the future is most unlike eternity, which is a wonderful Lewisian joke, because often we think of and associate eternity with the future, with what is to come. And of course, here Screwtape is saying it's the most unlike eternity. Well, of course, the high water mark of this letter is Screwtape's declaration that evil wants us to be hag-ridden by the future, a great 17th century word, which I acknowledge has paternalistic overtones, where we are affected by nightmares and anxieties. And as we think about evil's problem with the present, where we experience God as active in our midst, evil's use of the future becomes obvious, because when we cast our thoughts on the future, we almost always envision a future of our creation and one where God is not active. Notice the language Lewis uses in this section. Evil wants us to think we alone are necessary to bring about the good or to avert the bad that we see happening in the future. Evil wants us to think that the success of averting that danger or bringing about the good is dependent on us, with no place for God. And we're left often haunted by these visions of hell on earth, because of course, in those visions, God is not present, the very definition of hell. And this concept brings us to our final letter for this class, and one of my favorite Tolkien crossover references, which is the danger of despair. For those who finish the book, you know that by letter 29, things are looking pretty bleak for the patient. It is all but certain, writes Screwtape, that the patient's town will be carpet bombed by the Germans. And so Wormwood has written to Screwtape about how to use this fear. We talked about this letter in class 3 and how evil cannot produce the virtue of courage, which was one of the possible responses to the bombings. And so therefore, evil could only seek to twist courage into something unhealthy like nationalistic pride or hatred of the Germans. But for today's class, I want to point out what Screwtape says about using fear to produce cowardice, which ultimately leads to despair. Because from Screwtape's perspective, despair is a greater sin than any of the sins which provoke it. You can almost think of Screwtape licking his lips when he thinks about despair. Again, what makes despair so dangerous and so useful to evil is that it often goes hand in hand with the belief that God will not act in the future, or even better for evil, that God is not involved in the future. When we despair, we have given up hope that God is indeed active and present in our lives. We have given up hope, ultimately, that God loves us. Tolkien, and here's my chance to talk Tolkien, gives us an example of this kind of despair in the person of Denethor. If you've only seen the movies of The Lord of the Rings, you have not really seen Tolkien's version of Denethor. He is the steward of Gondor. He's appointed to rule the kingdom of Gondor until the return of the king. Right there, we've got a whole class on stewardship, but we'll skip that for now and just talk about Denethor and the Palantir. For Denethor in the book was actually a mighty and powerful leader of men and women, not this crazed, bitter, sloppy eater we see in the movie. For near the end of the book, as evil's forces are surrounding Gondor, where Denethor lives. Denethor gives into despair. And instead of rising to meet the challenge of this final battle, he commits suicide by immolation, claiming at the end, the West has failed. The West are all the free peoples of Lord of the Rings that are fighting against the great evil. Well, we learn after his death that he was in possession of a palantir, which is this crystal ball-ish type thing I've got in the picture that is some cross between a fortune-telling device and a cell phone, if you think of it this way. It had the ability to connect with other palantirs. There were seven of these seeing stones. And so when you looked into it, you could see things far away, and often you could see visions of the future. Well, Denethor has one of them, and he's been looking into his palantir, and he has seen the great forces of evil from the east that are surrounding his city, and he gives up hope. But what he'd forgotten, or perhaps didn't realize because of his own pride, is that the palantir he was using had been corrupted by the great evil of the Lord of the Rings, so that the only visions he could see were the visions the evil wanted him to see. He could not see all the ways that God was on the move, to borrow a phrase from Narnia and bring us back to Lewis. And so for him, he proclaims in despair before lighting himself aflame, the West has failed. Well, this all sounds like Screwtape's influence, doesn't it? Denethor was hag-ridden by the future, a future where he did not see God alive and active, working to advance God's kingdom and defeat the powers of evil. And so here is a challenge for you, which, as I was finishing up this presentation, we got news of Biden's victory and Trump's defeat. I don't know where you stand politically, but I suspect in one way or another, you might be feeling a little hag-ridden by possible futures. But I encourage you to stop and remember to make room for God in your vision of the future, and take hope, for God is already there. Your palantir, which might be a news channel or blogs or social media that you follow, those things that show you the future that you fear, remember, those things cannot always be trusted. Well, what are we supposed to do when we feel hag-ridden by the future? I've given you several hints in this class because the church has given us three very powerful antidotes for this fear. First, the church's calendar and the lectionary provide much needed reminders about what God has done, what God is doing, and what God will do in the future. We begin the great season of Advent at the end of this month, which is designed to put our focus not just on the first Advent, Jesus' birth, or the second Advent, which is Jesus' return, but also on the time where we live, which is in between these two Advents. Well, in addition to the calendar and the lectionary, all this talk of daily bread should, of course, brought to mind communion. For the Tolkien fans, we, of course, now can talk about Lembas bread, which is called Way bread in the book, which the fellowship receives to give them strength for their journey. But Tolkien, the Catholic, and Lewis, the Anglican, are really drawing our attention to the power of the Eucharist, where we remember that Christ has died, Christ has risen, and Christ will come again. That is a powerful antidote to anxiety about the future. And here, I'll be honest, having come from a tradition that had communion every week, I really feel the absence of communion in my life, especially during these times of anxiety and stress, because in communion, not only do I remember what God has done and the promises of what God will do, but in the bread and in the wine, I experience God. And that experience connects me with reality and therefore with eternity. And finally, we have Jesus, who has taught us to pray what we call now the Lord's Prayer, which is designed to draw our attention away from the past and the future, and instead to focus on the here and now, the present, the point at which time touches eternity. When I have found myself in the past, overcome by worries and anxieties about the future, when I have been hag-ridden by the future, I listen to a specific song that we'll listen to now, that the artist wrote as a meditation on the Lord's Prayer. So let's listen to it together.
Father, you always amaze me. Let your kingdom come in my world and in my life. Give me the food I need to live through today. And forgive me as I forgive the people that wrong me. Lead me far from temptation, deliver me from the evil one. I'll look out the window, the birds are composing, not a note is out of tune or out of place. Stare at the flowers, better dressed than any girl on her wedding day. So why should I worry? Why do I freak out? God knows what I need. You know what I need.
Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven, where eternity touches us here in time. I don't know where this video finds you today, but I pray that now, here in the present, that you have the strength to call upon God to give you the grace, the courage, and the strength to meet the challenges of tomorrow here today. For God to give you your daily bread for your journey, and to help you remember that God is strong and God loves us all. Thank you for joining me for this class. Now go in peace to love and serve the Lord. And until we meet again, I remain your affectionate brother in Christ, Carter.